The Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly before him. See, things like that will be quickened in prayer if you come into agreement with it, kind of like a little softened on Travis. Scriptures like that would really be quickened and made alive. And whenever a scripture is made alive in prayer, we get really happy, full of joy, and most times you just kind of go into the praying in the spirit or singing in the spirit. And sometimes you just get so happy you don't know what, how to respond. That's because the word of God has become quickened. And so we are just encouraging you to grab hold to as many of these scriptures that pertaining unto the Lord's compassion. Just grab, because we have taught that that portion of the scripture is the scripture that will build your faith and will set the stage for the miraculous quicker than any other portion of the scripture. Amen. That's what faith healers use to really get people's faith at a point where they can receive from God. Amen. So all of these scriptures, for instance, like, you know, it just kind of resonates in you, says, okay, you know, scriptures like this, that the Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. So that shows that God is full of even merit, and God is not a withholder. So in prayer, when you know that God is willing to pour out his mercy and his grace in great profusion on your life, then that really gives you extraordinary confidence to believe God for whatever you are seeking him for. Amen. Now, many times when scriptures like that, see, when you begin to look at the whole range of scriptures and how all of them are so closely related, for instance, like, the Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from them that walk it uprightly before him. Okay, that shows that God wants to pull out his blessings upon us in great profusion, but there's a part that we have to play that will enable God to do what he's eagerly yearning to do. That means that we have to walk upright before him. So God just doesn't arbitrarily just pull out all of his blessings upon anybody under any condition or circumstance. There's some conditions that God specifically said that we have to meet in order to be recipients of these rich blessings. Amen. Whenever that scripture comes to me, God gives me, no good thing will he withhold. It just jumps in my mind automatically because I've gone over these scriptures over and over. And you probably have heard them over and over and over and over and over and over from me. This scripture like this, it's Romans 8:32. God didn't spare his only son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall we not with him freely give us all things? And sometimes in prayer, God will quicken that and you will release that and say it in some form. Sometimes it might come out in the form of a song. Sometimes it might just come out in a what we call a shavak, a exclamation of praise. Amen. But those scriptures project God's love, and we just want to really, really try to reflect on these things while we're in prayer, because it will make your prayer so much richer than just praying the normal way that, you know, we are accustomed to praying. And see, all of these scriptures are just so rich. For instance, the Lord, the Bible says, he is rich to all of them that call upon him. He's rich to all of them that call upon him, and to all that call upon him in truth. God is rich. I mean, in other words, he eagerly yearns to meet us at our point of need. And that gives us great pleasure, great encouragement and inspiration. It inspires us in prayer. And so I like to take God's word and say it back to him. Repeat it back to him. Some say that's how you come into agreement with what God says. And sometimes people might say it this way. It's a way that you you come in agreement. And sometimes people call you, you affirm the word, or you acknowledge what God has what done for you. See, I'm really concerned about even developing a rich prayer life, because that's the key to everything. It's the thing that makes the word real. It's the thing that gives you motivation and zeal and fervor to carry out the will of God in terms of the things that you've been called to do. And it's the key to miracles, signs and wonders. Jesus did not do anything until he had waited before the Lord. Look, most times in long seasons of what? Prayer. Amen. So that's what I want to get over first. So those scriptures I gave you, I didn't just give them to you just for you to just, you know, have something to do, keep you busy. But these scriptures are given for you to feed on and to eat and to absorb and to get them in your system. And as the occasion occurs during prayer time, you speak it out and tell God, amen, what he has said concerning the love and the compassion that he has released toward you. So this is true, for instance, like how many of you like to acknowledge? And let me just acknowledge this right now. I really acknowledge all of you that gave me a birthday blessing. And, you know, people like to hear people acknowledge the things that they do. And that was a great source of blessing. Amen. Just to think you cared about. And people, amen, really have a certain degree of appreciation for you. So when we speak these things back to God, what we do, we are acknowledging the things that he has what? Done for us, who he has made us, and the provisions he has what released toward us. And that is a sweet smelling odor in the nostrils of God. He just loves that. And that's the reason why he repays you by making you real happy. And David said, my cup what runs over. Amen. And just try singing that. And when you get in the spirit, sometimes the Lord will put a little tune to a whole lot of scriptures that you are acknowledging. Amen. Try it at home. Amen. And you see that it is a real rich source of blessing. Okay, we are speaking about prayer because we are really focusing on prayer. And we want to make it so attractive, so exciting, until we we used to say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Okay, now, how many took notes of those scriptures that I gave you? One scripture says he gives to every man liberally. It's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So all of these scriptures project God as a what giver, not a titan. Fisted God, when you have to beg and plead and try to, amen, squeeze blessings out from him. He wants to do it. He wants to shower his blessings on you. So God loves us. Amen. And we can prove that he loved us because the scripture says, perceive we the love of God, that he laid down his life for us. The love of God laid down his life for us. He loved us. Amen. To the extent of laying down his life, we are to love who? One another. Amen. Praise God. Now, if you have a record of all of those scriptures, that will be the foundation that our prayer in 2012 will be based on, and we're going to build on that we're going to build on the Lord's compassion. Everybody said, we're going to build on that. All right, so we got to lay the foundation. If you need to do some more work on your foundation, amen, I'm working on the building. This was your foundation. Lifting up a blood stain. All right, so that's your foundation. Now I'm going to the main point, the mainest point. All right, you have a little meditation book there. In chapter 7, it says the ministry of reconciliation. And I think that you are privileged to be able to have these types of meditation because, and this. Yeah. Okay.
And that is all the scriptures that you gave us. We have all things that he gives us all things that
he gave us.
And you know, as you said, your repetitious teaching, you can call it over and over. Mm-hmm. That's how we learn. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I would like to say is that when we quote the scriptures, sometimes all things are not only wrong. Mm-hmm. We don't have all things. Mm-hmm. But and sometimes there are needs. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, I'm quoting scripture, you know, and I don't have all things. Mm-hmm. What's the deal? What's the problem? And I think it's important to mention that we have to continue to do that. Continue to say it. And what that does is keep us in the frame of mind, the attitude that I don't have it now, just like with Abraham when God made the promise. He did it. I don't see a son. And then a year passed, 2 years, I don't see it. But God had made the promise. And in due time, it came to fruition. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to look for, when we're quoting these scriptures, look for it in due time. If God made this promise, and I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, it's going to happen. My position is to do what's learn the scriptures, do it, and wait for it. And often it'll happen in the time that we least expect it. But if we're not in the attitude of expectancy, and if the scripture is not a part of us, it may pass us by. Mm-hmm. You never recognize it. Because if you look at all these scriptures, I'm sure people do have questions like, this is good. He's compassionate, but I don't have all this. Mm-hmm. You know. So somehow there has to be some type of bringing together in our minds in terms of what we need to do.
All right. Well, I'm glad you got into that because I'm just about to get into it. Okay, but still, you know, always kind of blow my mind. About sometimes at home, she said, I'm about to say something. She said, wait a minute. I'm going to tell you what you're going to say. I guess that happened to me. Stay together all these years. I'll tell you. You go closer together, the heart grows finer. So two supposed to be become what? One. They that are joined together become what? One spirit.
Does that make sense?
Yes. All right. Okay, very good. We're going to kind of deal with that. But it's a whole lot in acknowledging the things that God has made us or provided, or the love and the care that he has released toward us. All of these are things that we want to acknowledge. Okay, tell me the power of acknowledgement. Somebody might want to just say a word, the power of acknowledgement. When you acknowledge the good things, and the Bible tells about that we are to consistently acknowledge the things that God, Sister Denise, find the scripture. All right. The power of acknowledgement is phenomenal. Okay, what does that do? What kind of motivation does that give? The giver. No. Okay, I just hold right here in like Philippians 1. But anyway, whenever you acknowledge the good things that people do for you, then it motivates them to what? To continue or to what? Give you even what? More. Everybody agree with that? Okay, but when you take people for granted and you don't acknowledge and they're constantly giving, then that what? That kind of what? That sometimes causes the blessings to dry up, right? So that's the reason why we want to acknowledge these things, because when we acknowledge these things, then a greater degree of grace can be imparted to us. Okay, now, the key to all that we have just shared about God's mercy, God's love, and God's eager yearning, the thing that enables God to release these things into our life, one of the greatest things would be you showing mercy. In other words, you're following the example. The Bible says we have to be followers of Christ. We have to emulate or imitate the imitators of God. If we want these blessings, all of this mercy, all of this grace, the fullness of his eager yearning, if we want this released into our lives, then the key, probably more than any other thing, would be what? Mercy. Show mercy. Show mercy. Show mercy. Amen. That means that we have to get into harmony with the Spirit of God. We have to follow Christ in terms of how he lived his life, his purpose, and the things that he did while he was down here on the earth. Jesus actually was a reflection of God. He was the image and the reflection of God. In other words, the reason why Jesus came, he came to show people without a doubt, beyond a shadow of a doubt, what God's heart is all about. If people really want to know the nature of God, the virtues of God, whether God is good, whether God is a God, more of a God of a judgment type, or a hostile God, a loving God, a peaceful God, all you have to do is to look at the things that God did through Jesus to project his love and his concern for humanity. Amen. Scripture says, Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with what power? And he went about doing what? Good. And healing all of those that were what? Oppressed of the devil. So God wants us to be a reflection of him. He wants us to live the Jesus life. Whatever Jesus did, whatever works he did, whatever compassion that he was moved by, whatever his ministry was comprised of, that's the thing that will bring great, 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 great blessings into your life. Amen. Praise God. So, since we know that the ministry of reconciliation, this is the ministry in which we get involved with people in meeting their needs and coming to their rescue and be in touch with the feelings of their infirmities and not living our lives unto ourselves, but living our lives unto Jesus who died for us and who gave his life. Bible says he died and he rose again. Amen. So this is the key to real, real, real blessings and fulfillment. How many want to be fulfilled? How many want all of your dreams and expectations and the things that you long for? Amen. How many want these things fulfilled? Okay. So this chapter, chapter 7, it takes us a little further in prayer because it actually shows what God has the ability that God has given us to do the same things that he did. The ability, amen, the virtues that God has placed in us so that we can release the same measure of love and compassion in our lives that Jesus actually demonstrated when he was down here on the earth. So now, how many understand this? I hope we can understand that whatever you want to quicken, whatever part of a word that you really want to flow in, whatever part of a word that you really want to become reality in your life, that's the area of the word that you want to focus on. And we feel that at this point, we want to build the word of God into our hearts concerning the ministry of reconciliation, because we can see the great need. Now, I was here this morning early, and I just took out a piece of paper, and I just began to think about all of the people that needed someone to just reach out to them, that's a part of this ministry or connected with this ministry in some form. And the scripture says that, let me see if I can find this scripture right quick. Okay. Turn to 1 John 3, 1 John 4, it's one of them. First John 3, I'm going to read that one. 1 John 3, through 16, 17. Okay, now, last month, I don't know how many weeks, I talked about God's compassion toward us. Now I'm talking about our compassion toward our brothers. I'm talking about our compassion to our neighbor, those that have need. Amen. How many remember the example about the lawyer that asked Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? In other words, he wanted God's what? Grace. He wanted those mercies released into his life. And Jesus went on to tell him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your what? Neighbor. Then he questioned him, who is my neighbor? Did Jesus explain it to him real good? Did he make it clear? All right, he made it clear then. Who is my neighbor? You might want to ask, who is my neighbor? Because the scripture says we have to love our what? Neighbor, as I said. Okay. Okay, this scripture here says, Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And we ought to what? Lay down our lives for the brother. We ought to lay down our lives for the brother. All right? But whoso hath this world's good and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemn us not, God is greater than our heart, knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Okay, so that puts it in a nutshell. If you really want to place yourself in a position where the blessings that God has bountifully provided us are released into our lives, the scripture says that love is the thing that will assure our hearts. Love is the thing that will perfect us. He will place us in a position where God's love, God's rich blessings will begin to come on us and overtake us. And he made it very clear, we have to follow the example of Jesus. And that 16th and 17th verse shows the God side of it, and verse 17 shows man's side, what man has to do. All right? Amen. God laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for the brother.
I'm going to ask a question.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And that's not in verse 16. Mm-hmm. What does it mean that we often lay down our life for the brother?
Okay.
What does that mean?
All right. We want to know, what does that mean? We should lay down our lives for the brother. So, Irene looks so intelligent and face looks so bright and fresh tonight. Maybe she want to start us out. Singing songs like this, receiving the love of God, and he laid down his life for us, and if he laid down his life for us. Other morning, you know, I can't do it until I get in the spirit, man. I can sometimes get it in a little melody by just singing over and over and over, and it kind of rhymes, and it hits a nice little tune. I really enjoy that. But that way, it just stick with you. It'll just go with you all the time. All the time. Amen. Perceived with the love of God that he laid down his life for us. If he laid down his life for us, we'll be willing to lay down our lives for our brother. If we see, if any man see his brother in need, and it goes right, if all of it flows together and does what? Close up, shut it up, his bowel of compassion. Compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God. Amen. See if his brother in need, whoso had this world's good. Okay, that pertains maybe to material things. But it doesn't necessarily have to always be material things that we see people have what need of. Amen. But the point here is that we're not to withhold good from them to whom it is what? Do when it is in the power of your hand to do. Okay, that's the scripture that you want to learn. Because these scriptures go with man's side of the relationship. Okay. And let me give you that scripture. Because we're, now we are building scriptures into our spirits so we can pray them, reflect on them, and be motivated by them. That will reflect the things that we are to what release toward men in order for these blessings to be released into our lives. Because the scripture says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall what? Obtain what? Mercy. Amen. To them that are merciful, God will show himself what? Merciful. Okay, brother. Travis, he wants to work on you a little bit more. Okay. That was Proverbs 3:27. Withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of thine hand to do it. All right. Okay. Okay. Now, thank you. That's better. That's a whole lot better. I really appreciate that. Lord. Okay. Here's another one that kind of fits there. I don't want to give you too many scriptures because I don't want to oversaturate you tonight. All right. This is Saint John, 1 John 4. Nine, and this was manifested, and this was manifest. In other words, this is the way God demonstrated his love. You know, love ain't love unless it's what? Your action. It's got to what be demonstrated. Amen. Sometimes people say, oh, I really sympathize with you. But sympathy is different from love. Is that right? Compassion. I mean, compassion means that what? You actually what? You like the priest and the Levite, they sympathized, I'm sure, with the man.
Sympathy means
you
feel sorry.
Right, have pity.
Compassion means
all right. Compassion means to be moved. Compassion means to you move your hand to what? Amen. I like this. And this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son, amen, into the world that we might live through him. The only begotten Son. That's the only begotten Son that he had. Okay. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation. That's a big word. What do you think that might mean, propitiation? It means what? The propitiation of the what? The atoning sacrifice, right? The atoning sacrifice for our sin. He took our place. So we can become like, he became like us so that we can become like him. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to, what, love one another. Amen. So I'm just going to just kind of share a little bit here because I got, in this chapter, you will find a whole lot of scriptures that deals with the ability that God has given us to impact people. Chapter 7, we're still, okay, under, this is the mention of reconciliation, chapter 7, meditation. Anybody hear me say that?
Yeah, you said chapter 4.
All right, well, look at that. Okay, well, you need both of them. This is for prayer. This is for prayer.
Which one you bring?
And
well, I got the true disciple from him, but I couldn't find him, and I left the meditation at home.
Okay.
I did too.
Yeah. All right. The true disciple will be on Wednesday night. That's what we are trying to build up to tonight. But this is the foundation since we're praying. So I just wanted to just kind of give you.
Okay, we're in chapter 7 meditation.
Mm-hmm, right now.
Alrighty.
Okay. Now I just want you to say, look at this, just to see how all of this ties together. The first part of it is our call to reach the lost. And how many will agree that that is the ministry that we are dealing with tonight, the ministry of reconciliation? All of us are held accountable for people that, you know, cross our path, people that we rub shoulders against, people that we can reach. and people that we have the ability to impact. Okay, I called you to us. Now look at the second part, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. That is the main reason why we are children of God. We are here to what? Carry out the works that Jesus began to do. He has no other way to fulfill his ministry, his work, outside of his body. We are the body of Christ. Amen. How many agree with that? And the way that you really get fired up to flow in this anointing is that you begin to focus on scriptures like we are dealing with here. You focus your attention. If you really want to get in the flow of the ministry of reconciliation, then you begin to meditate. Does that make any sense to anybody? You meditate and you go over these scriptures. You acknowledge them, right? Amen. And you praise God for that, what? That call and that ability and what he has placed in you that enables you to what? To be, the Bible says he's made us able ministers of what? The new covenant. So all of these things are things that we are going to be dealing with in prayer as we begin to pray for a greater anointing. And there are some specific things that we're going to mention tonight that we want the women group to begin to focus on. And there are some things that we want the men group to focus on. And there are some things that we want every person to begin to what? Focus on. And then we're going to get to that very shortly. But I'm just showing you what you have at your disposal that can really enrich your life and set the tone for what you want to see happen. Amen. This year through your ministry. There's a lot of different facets of ministry that we want to perfect, but we want to lay the groundwork and begin to build the Word of God into our hearts concerning, amen, our call and our responsibilities as believers. Okay. Now, creating the Christ into good works, that is a section that you can really be enriched by. Page 55, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. All of these scriptures are showing the reason why we are believers. Chosen generation, called to show forth the glory of him, called who called us out of darkness into the marvelous light. Bible says in Titus 2, peculiar people, zealous of good works. Amen. Then it also shows over in the other scriptures, be careful to maintain good works and so forth and so on. Even faith without works is dead. I was just meditating on that the other morning, and it really, really, really blessed me. If you just read that portion, it shows you that, you know, if we pray, come to church, and our works are lagging. If our works are not following our, you know, coming to church or our prayer life, the Bible says faith without works is what? Dead. It can become pretty perfunctory. We can become almost like actors in a play if we don't add what? True compassion to our what? The things that we are offering to God. Amen. I want to get away from that personally. Sometimes I have to force myself to go and show compassion. So I just won't just make, you know, coming, teaching, and preaching just what? Perfunctory. Because it can become so perfunctory that you can do it without even what? Praying or seeking God or doing things that you should do in order for the word to be effective. Okay, now, made able ministers of a new covenant. And this is the section that you want to acknowledge. You know, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Amen. Amen. Lay your hands on Sister Denise, brother. Sonny, and just say, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. See that? See that? You were, she smiled. It's a good feeling. Hallelujah. Hey, he has anointed me. Woo, glory. Boy, sometimes in prayer, I just walk up and down. Lord, he has anointed me. Woo, glory. Hey, he has sent me. What does that make you feel? Real special. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach what? Deliverance to the captive. Mm-hmm. Oh, God. See, when you begin to agree with things like this, man, you put new life. Amen. It makes Jesus, amen, your hero indeed. Amen. It puts life. So you want to do everything, because when you begin to go into these homes, when you begin to get on the telephone, when you begin to pray for people that's going through all types of adversity and trouble, you will need every drop of what? Anointing and strength and encouragement and motivation.